So today, lecture number 3, Self and Society, Social Phenomenology. Let me make a few comments first about the discussion that we had on Thursday that was not included on the videotape. We talked a lot about routinization. We used the reading from Beyond Caring and talked about how people get used to working in a hospital and what are the different components of that and what does it mean to get used to something and things of that sort. And a number of points came out that I thought were worth repeating, okay? And there are, I would frame them as comments about the definition of the situation and that whole idea. And I listed them on the board here, but let me explain each. We can say at least 5 things. Number 1, what we mean by the definition of the situation is the inherently ambiguous answer to the question, what is going on here? That is, you walk into any setting and the first thing you have to do, okay, and you do it, you don't necessarily think it, is you have to decide, and again, it's not necessarily cognitive or conscious or deliberate at all. You have to decide what's going on here, what's happening in this setting. So you walk into this room and you go, oh, look, there are people taking notes and there's a person standing up front lecturing and so on. Must be a class. And then that sets off a whole series of other things, right? So the first thing you do is define the situation. Now, again, it may be that you have to stop and think about it. It may be it just sort of happens naturally and you don't notice it at all. But it's always there, right? There's always some definition of the situation going on. Number 2, within a situational definition, we seem to live in what you might think of as coherent chunks of action. That is, once you know this is a class, that implies a whole bunch of other things about kind of scripts that you follow as if you were in a play, ways of talking, ways of carrying yourself, how you pay attention, how long this is going to last, like an hour and 15 minutes, not, say, 3 years, how you behave, what kind of roles there are within it, how different people are supposed to fit in, what different objects mean, and how they're to be regarded, and so on. Okay, so there are these coherent chunks of action. And phenomenologically, it's kind of interesting because what that means is that once you start in a situation and have decided what it is, a lot of other stuff kind of follows automatically. So again, it's almost like a chunk of behavior, the way when you tie your shoes, once you know, okay, tie my shoe, and you start it, it just kind of unfolds, right? Which is, as people pointed out, it becomes, I'm jumping ahead here, but it kind of becomes like muscle memory. So there is a physical component there, obviously, but everything else kind of happens like a package of behavior that just kind of automatically unfolds. I'm trying to describe the way I think we mostly experience it, right? You're in a situation, you know, like, okay, I'm a good student, I'm sitting on the front row, I'm taking notes, I'm paying attention, you know, I'm asking questions. And you don't have to think about every step of it, right? It just kind of blah, 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 blah. And then at the end of class, you say, okay, now what? Check your calendar, on to the next thing. And you move into that next situation. There's one caveat there, which is the way I just expressed it sounds as if there are situations and they're all discrete, but in fact, there's an underlying situation. You're never out of that kind of reality. Okay, there's no place apart from being in a defined situation where you have to, in effect, decide what kind of person you're going to be and how you're going to behave and so on and so on. Okay? Third point that came up, we do these things, these situations, with other people. So they're social, right? And so in carrying on our lives, right, we're dealing with other people. Now that turns out to be incredibly important, a big surprise, sociology class. Turns out the other people are incredibly important because, as I mentioned, I think on day one, you can't be who you want to be without the collaboration of other folks. It's very hard, my examples, to be a nice person if other people regard your actions as condescending or sarcastic or snide or whatever, right? So again, you enter a situation, you have to gear in, as Schutz said, with other people. You have to mesh with other people and what they're doing as well. So you can't just arbitrarily pick a new definition of a situation. You've got to be able to, so to speak, pull it off with other folks involved. And again, a couple of people pointed out, wait, that's you almost have to do this stuff physically, which is true, because part of any self, we might say, is the physical component of that, being who you are physically, carrying yourself in a certain way, or being able to talk, to express the kind of person you're trying to be, or gesture, or to see other people, so you can pick up how you're fitting together with them. You see? So all of these things kind of fit together. There is intrinsically ambiguous meaning involved all the time, and so on and so on. Okay? So, today what we're going to do is we're going to start talking about, in that sort of world that's intrinsically meaningful all the time and yet kind of ambiguous and social and all the rest, what does it mean to have a self? Now, we started off the course with this notion of a kind of, with the notion that a self, what we mean by the self, phenomenologically speaking, that is, if I look at my own kind of first-person experience, the self has what we've thought of so far as a kind of Sartrean freedom. Okay, so we read Jean-Paul Sartre's article on existentialism, and he says, look, people have this freedom. There's no way out of it. You've always got a future that's in some way or other, open. You can choose to do different things. You don't have to keep going the way you've been going. And that's always a possibility out in front of you. Whoever you've been up until now, you can, in effect, be somebody else. So that freedom is an important part of the self. Okay. So let's look at, if you see your outline here, let me say a couple of things about this Sartrean freedom first, and then move into what the self would be then. All right. It means that I'm constantly acting in the world. I'm always doing stuff, even if it's in the form of not doing anything. Wake up one morning and you're lying in bed and you stare at the ceiling and say, like, I hate school. I don't like being here. I think I'll go back to sleep. And if you do that, let's say 4 weeks in a row, people will notice, right? You're starting to make a statement about yourself, like it or not. There's no such thing as leaving the world, so to speak, without doing something. You have no choice but to act. Second thing Sartre talks about is by acting, he says, this is a strong claim that we argued about, you're defining who you are. That is the way Sartre says, the way that you actually live, that's who you are. There's no secret hidden you behind the scenes. You can't be a great lover if you've never been in love. Right? You can't be a great parent if you've never had children. Okay, what you think you really are, you can't, you know, be a deep down nice person if you're a jerk day after day after day. So, people are defined, Sartre says, by their actual lives, not by some other realm. Now, that means you could, for instance, sit down and keep track of who you really are, like keep a time log for the next week or two, and how you spend your time, and it turns out, wow, I'm a first-rate TV viewer. I'm really, really into television. That's what I'm doing with my life. watching TV. Now, you may say to yourself, well, but you know, this is different. This is college. This doesn't really count. What really counts is after you get out of college and you're in what we call the real world. As if all of this is just some sort of big preliminary and it somehow doesn't matter. Well, you can feel that way. That's fine. A lot of people do. Sartre would say you're fooling yourself. Here you are. You're doing stuff right now. And that's deliberate's the wrong word, because you may not sit down and think about it until you've had a class like this and you go, oh, sure. I'm turned into like a TV watcher. Or, you know, I'm a great video game person or something like that. That's what I'm doing. But anyway, that's all in there. That who you are, what you actually do is what counts. Third point, and this was real controversial for some folks. By acting, Sartre says, I make a statement of what's important in the world. Or more strongly put, I decide what is good, is what he says, for the whole world, by my action. Now, a lot of people were bothered by this because they said, well, you know that there are a lot of people who do things that they know are not good. I mean, first claim was, people do things that don't really represent who they are. Sartre's answer to that is like, what does that mean? Here you are, you're doing. That is who you are. The stronger claim is, if you do something, even if you think it's bad, you're saying it's good. Because there's no stronger statement of what you think is good than what you actually do. Talk is cheap. Actions speak louder than words, etc., right? So by your acting in whatever direction, you are making, in effect, a moral claim that this is the way one should act. That's what he's saying. All right, that brings us up to where we are. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is a couple of the features of a self that lives in this way. That is, if you accept sort of Sartre's basic findings, he would say, like, he's looked at life, he's thought about himself, he's thought about freedom and all this, and he says, here's kind of basic principles. If you can accept those basic ideas that we're free to act and it matters and we're doing things in the world and so on, what does that mean for the self? All right, that's our topic of the day. All right. Point number one. Number one. When you talk about a person having a self, ourselves are always typified in some way or other, even if you're standing alone. That is, we think of ourselves, might be a way of thinking of it, as a certain type of person. So you think of yourself as, you know, a good person or a bad person, or male or female, or an athlete or a student, or nice or bad, or I don't know what, right? In all kind of different adjectives you can apply to yourself, right? Now we'll get into a little of the detail here in a minute, but a lot of times that's just sort of taken for granted. You kind of know who you are, more or less. You've been used to it. You've done it for a long time. You kind of know how you operate, might be another way of thinking of it. But you have a reasonably clear notion of who you are and how you react to things and so on. And you could probably define that. Now, a bunch of things can mess that up. And that's what I actually have here on your sheet next. It's a little out of sequence. But for instance, if you're a senior about to graduate from college, some people are it's a little different. That is, who you are is a little bit up in the air all of a sudden, like, ugh. Okay, I've managed things so far for the last, 4 years or whatever, pretty good. I'm, you know, I got a little place here, people know who I am, they treat me nicely, have lunch with me and stuff like that. got to get a job. What kind of job? I don't know. I know, I'll go to school some more. See, that works, right? Because you're in the same mode. Or it could be that you you turn 65. Not you, but okay, me, my wife, whoever, various people. I know. You know, they're retiring. You retire from a job that you've been in for a long time and that you have a lot of stake in, right? A lot of, you care about a lot. Can be totally traumatic. Because all of a sudden you're like, what do I, not just what do I do or how do I make money, but who am I? How do I spend my days? How does that work? And this is a real problem because you hang your idea of yourself, again, on what you do or what you have done or something you can, when you talk to yourself, much less to other people, it's nice to be able to say, you know, oh, I'm a college professor. Oh, okay, lots of problems solved, right? Situational definitions are much easier to pick. Oh, he's a college professor. We know how they are, you know. Okay, all right. But there are times when these things get challenged. You break up with your boyfriend or your girlfriend. You've been together since seventh grade. It's been a big deal. You were always planning to get married. You're going to have kids. One day they call up. They're like, I kind of met somebody. You kind of met somebody? What does that mean? I really like college in Colorado. You like college? Well, I'm not there. Right? And you have this thing, and then it's like, well, who am I if I'm not with that person? You know, and a chunk of you kind of breaks off and floats away. And divorce, of course, is, you know, one of the worst cases of this kind of thing. People, especially if they've done it, you know, they've been married for a long time, big investment, a lot of other people involved, you know, relatives and kids and friends, and all of a sudden, you know, like, oh, you know, dad's leaving town. Because otherwise he runs into the same people every, you know, at the restaurant. It's kind of awkward. Like, this kind of business, right? Can really throw your life out of kilter. All right. But apart from these traumatic events, usually who you are is not a big problem for most of us. You kind of have a pretty clear sense of it and you manage. There's a routine, again, kind of backing it up. All right? Next point. Yourself probably fits into a kind of recognizable biography. If I say to you, who are you? You could probably answer that question reasonably well. Say, you know, examples I gave. I'm a sophomore living in Dunham. I'm a neuroscience major. I'm really committed to work with Habitat for Humanity. I go on alternative spring break. I'm in the choir. Oh, okay, that worked. And then you announce yourself to other people and they kind of have a picture of who you are. Now, an interesting exercise, Irving Goffman kind of suggested such a thing. Interesting exercise is to write your little biography. Now, you did this probably when you applied to college. I don't know if they asked you to. Did they ask you to do this? Something like that? Tell us about yourself. Okay, so you have a picture. You say, oh, yeah, you know, I grew up in Darien. You know, I went to this school, and I really enjoy doing such and such. And I spend my free time doing blah, blah, blah. And you leave out, like, the TV and the video games part, maybe. And you write this little standard story about yourself. Well, an interesting trick is to scribble that out, like in a paragraph for yourself, and then turn the paper over. And your, by the way, your biography brings you up to now being, you know, a successful student at Hamilton College with lots of friends, and, you know, you're doing great things, and I'm on my way to a career as a physical therapist or whatever it is. Flip the page over, and then rewrite the biography, ending up with you, like, going into sociology class and shooting your classmates and the professor. Okay, think about it. Work back. In fourth grade, I was really mean to that girl in gym, right? In sixth grade, I bought a knife. I played with it a lot. I hid it from my parents so they wouldn't know. or I did something wicked or evil or whatever it is. Maybe the mass murder is not a great example. Okay. So think of something where you wind up, I don't know, you wind up in prison. It's a lot easier. Everybody's got this one. So it turns out probably almost everyone in the room has probably committed a felony by this point in your life. Yeah, you know, like there's the drug thing, you know, there's stealing of various sorts, all that, right? And you could write a little biography of yourself that comes up to the present where it all makes sense and fits together. And there was stuff earlier in your life that kind of leads to some bad outcome of that sort. Okay? So alternative biographies are very possible. And if you get arrested, this and something big, bad happens, this may well be the case. Newspaper reporters will find out things. Now, something good happens with you, they'll talk about you were an honor student, you know, and you made the varsity when in 10th grade, and you got really good grades. Everybody said how nice you were. But if something bad happens, they can easily pick out stuff, they can easily pick out stuff from your previous, from your earlier life, that kind of shows how it makes sense that you wind up where you are today. Okay. So all of that, so it's possible to construct alternate biographies for yourself. It's not as if we just are X or Y or Z, right? So all of this suggests that it's kind of, you can think of yourself as a concept, as an idea. That is, I have an idea of who I am. There's something more to me than just all of these different things I do. There's a kind of coherent, you might say, stereotype of who I am. So you really see this in cases of big famous people. I listed a few. Karl Marx. We think Karl Marx, right? Or Max Weber. I'm thinking of names in sociology. Barack Obama. Barack Obama. And you've seen him on TV, and there's this whole idea, and there's these posters and pictures and things, and the name kind of resonates. And if you ever met him, you'd be sort of like, that's really him. Have you ever seen ever seen a famous person live? Yeah, okay. Were you sort of shocked, or wouldn't it? It's a strange experience, right? That's actually Mick Jagger. He's across the street. He's right over there. You know, or you walk around the corner in New York, this happens fairly often. You walk around the corner, you're like, that's, I mean, my stepdaughter was working in a store in New York recently, and Oprah Winfrey walks in. And you're just, because you can't imagine there's an actual person, you know? It's not just this big idea out there. There's this human being, and she walks over and says hi, and you're like this, right? Because Oprah Winfrey is not just a real human being, it's an idea. And the same applies to you and me. Now, Barack Obama, another example, is an idea as much as a live human being. But he's a live human being, okay? And he made a comment in an interview, I don't know, about a year ago I read, that was really interesting, which was, the reporter was saying, well, there are all these people who really hate you and stuff. And he says, yeah, he said, but you're in politics. He says, you realize they don't hate me. I mean, they hate me, okay? He's got that. But he said, they don't hate me. They hate some idea they have. And I sort of represent it. Right? They're not really dealing with the live human being in front of them. Okay, now what I'm suggesting to you is that's true of your dealings with other people all the time anyway. You're not always dealing with the live person right in front of you. You're dealing with your idea of that person that you've developed maybe over years and years. And maybe that's a great thing, okay? And you go, oh, well, she's just in a bad mood today. Okay. See, so in that case, you're dealing with the concept of that person, not the person, in a sense, who's standing right in front of you, right in front of you. Okay. On to Roman numeral 2. Now, everybody has a self in this sense. Everybody has an image, both to themselves and other people, of who they are. The concept of this particular person. The idea of me, apart from the particulars of my real life. Okay? Everybody has this. Now, what I'm going to do is give you some examples of how that concept or that idea can be challenged. That is, you have a notion of who you are, but stuff comes up all the time that can change it, sometimes for good, sometimes for bad. Have you ever gotten a secret Valentine? Anybody yet? Okay, see? My image of you just went up, right? It's like, that's good, that's good. Secret Valentines are good, right? You get an anonymous card from somebody. It says, you know, I got a sweet on you. Okay, so I was in college, and I got this big, not Valentine's Day is coming up. If you want to make somebody happy, send them a Valentine. Secret Valentine, even better. Why? Why is a secret Valentine better?
Because they can choose who they want it to be.
They can choose who you want it to be from. Right? I got a great one. It was homemade, big red construction with a silver, aluminum foil backing and a doily, you know, the heart cut out from a doily, like the lacy stuff.
This is great.
I pull out. And for the next, 4 days, I'm walking around campus, like, every girl I'd ever had a crush on. Okay, I'm like, you know, hi. You know? It's wide open. It's an unlimited field of possibilities. It's fabulous. And my self-image, Dan's Mr. Cool, I don't know, whatever. And then at dinner one night, one of my friends, Debbie, says, so, did you get any secret Valentines? And I'm like, you're telling me this? You can't tell. And I'm just deflating. I mean, she was very nice, okay? I like Debbie and all that. But still do. We're friends on Facebook. She's great. But she's not as great as the multiple women who before that had been in love with me. That's just the way it was. So self-image, all right. So different sort of example. You can sometimes discover things about yourself, again, for good or for bad. So when I was a kid, I always thought of myself as, it wasn't just a thought, it was objective reality. I was a terrible athlete, understand? I mean, terrible, last picked for anything. I was little, I was uncoordinated, I had no strength, I couldn't run, blah, 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 okay? No athlete whatsoever. And then, I mentioned this to you, I think, once before, a couple of times probably, is through a series of, not flukes, that wouldn't be right, but odd events, in a matter of one summer, I became quite a good competitive swimmer. Go figure, can't do this nowadays, but, back in 67, it was possible. So I become this kind of, I'm in the newspaper, a lot of attention, prominent sort of athlete. Boom, all of a sudden, I'm an athlete. This was fabulous, okay, this is fabulous. So I get up on the blocks, in the finals of this big championship meet, and there are all these guys, 6'2", and I'm in the middle of the crowd, right? And I beat them. And it was, whoa! And I loved the surprise element of that, okay? There was something. It's like, it's like justice is mine kind of thing, right? You find yeah, good guy won, right? Like I got there on something that you don't have. And that surprise element of that was quite appealing. And in fact, and there was another component of it, which was that later, so the first part is, it might be what I enjoyed about it, I'm sharing this with you, was the kind of hidden power or the sense that I could do stuff that wasn't at all obvious to most people, how I did it. Like they look at me and I did not look athletic at all. I mean, the joke is I'd walk around high school, we had letter jackets. Do y'all have letter jackets still? People do that? No, people don't do that anymore. You know what I'm talking about though? Like big, bulky leather thing. It was way too big on me because I planned to grow. I'm wearing this biggest leather jacket. This little guy, people, whoa, dude, where'd that come from? It's mine. And so it was the sense that I could kind of pull something out that people didn't know was there, right? And that's really kind of cool. It's like those, like vigilante movies or something, where the little guy turns out to have a real bad gun, you know, and somebody's giving him a hard time, and he goes like this, and all of a sudden they're like, "Arr!" Right? The little guy's like, "See, that's the way I felt." That's kind of the way I felt. Anyway, so that really works. But that's another side of yourself that's not particularly obvious. One other iteration of that, and then I'll shut up about the swimming stuff, was I've always thought of myself as lazy. Okay, I really enjoy naps. I love lying in a bathtub and just like this and like nothing. My idea of a vacation is lying on a sofa for 3 days. Okay, I'm lazy. But in competitive swimming, huh, I was a monster, maniac, workaholic. I mean, when I swam doubles, you know, I'll talk about swimming doubles, you mean morning and night. I'm talking going to two different practices in the same evening with two different teams. Swimming two full practices with two different teams, sequentially, an hour apart, with an hour in between, right? Nope, that was maniacal in those days, right? And I enjoyed being maniacal. Because people are like, one thing you can't say about Chandler, he ain't lazy. But I thought of myself as lazy. And this was just my way. Every damn day I had to prove it to myself. Now, there's something a little marginally pathological, but we'll leave that out. Okay. Another possibility of changing who you are, there can be radical changes. We said, like, divorce or something like that. Big change would be something like an FBI informant changes their identity. You ever seen Goodfellas? The movie, Goodfellas? This is a very good movie. It's worth seeing. The movie starts off, the guy is saying, ever since I was a kid, I forget the exact words, but ever since I was a kid, I wanted to be a gangster. Right? That's what he wanted to be. And he loved it. He really enjoyed being a gangster. At the end of the movie, he turns FBI informant, right? Testifies against all his old buddies. And they wind up changing his identity and putting him in some suburb out in Nevada or something. And he says at the end of the movie something about, now I have to live the rest of my life as a schnook, meaning a schlemiel, hapless loser, kind of an ordinary guy, nobody knows, never done anything interesting, just kind of plodding along, gets the pay. Right? At the end of the movie, he's just like, stand there in this suburb. He walks out, he gets the newspaper. He's like, walks back in his house, living in the suburbs. Right? Total change of who he could be. And it just violated his sense of self all over the place. Okay, let's go on. So, a final example of that would be that I have here, pro athletes when they retire. This is bad. Okay, because guys, you just watch the Super Bowl? That's a great football game, right? I'm not a football fan, but that was a good football game, second half. When those guys retire, they suffer mightily. I mean, first off, they've got all kind of physical problems, we know that. But they also, there's something like within 3 years, 50% of them are divorced, 3 years after they retire, right? And lots of them are clinically depressed. It is a very big problem because not just because their income takes a huge hit, and not just because the NFL cuts off their health insurance after 3 years, which I believe is what it is. They're not living high the rest of their life, not at all. Right? By the age of 29 or 30, they're gone, and unless you're Eli Manning or somebody, they're also poor. Right? It's not a good way to make a living. But the big problem is they've spent their entire life up to that point being an athlete, being a great athlete, and getting a lot of attention all the way from junior high on, and probably being, well, like, what's his name? The Kaepernick? His name? The quarterback for the 49ers?
Yeah.
Throws a 94-mile-an-hour fastball in high school. He was drafted by the Chicago Cubs. Baseball team. Goes into football instead. Maybe a good decision, maybe not. Baseball has much better use. Okay, so, but, you know, if something happens to him, if he gets injured, you know, somebody whams into him, breaks his knee, and that's the end of his athletic career, I mean, he's a bad example because he's famous, okay? But most NFL players are not famous. And their career can end like that. And that's it. And all of a sudden, this big life they've had of lots of attention and lots of fame and glory and, you know, in the papers and on TV and all the girlfriends and all that stuff, boom, gone. If they're lucky, they wind up starting a restaurant, you know, maybe, with whatever pittance of savings they still have. It's a very big problem if you ever looked into this sort of thing. Former pro athletes, mostly not a good lifestyle, not a good way to live. Now, very few, the ones you hear about, are famous and glamorous and have all their things, you know, and maybe they make movies or something like that. But mostly not so good. Okay, let's go on. So, the self, one thing is that the self includes an idea of who you are. That we can understand, right? Sort of phenomenologically. That's a big part of having a self. Okay, what are the other components? Well, it starts with having a body. All right, so that's in there. Like your physical self really, really matters. And even Karl Marx or Charlotte Bronte or Jane Austen, those people were all physical people at a certain point. Now, you know, they may be dead now, but they had to physically exist. And the way they physically existed mattered. That is, they were able to write. I mean, they could physically manage whatever it took to do that. Or to read, because they weren't blind. Right? Or they weren't grotesquely sick all the time. So they had time to, you know, read books and study, and then they could write books, for instance. And if you're badly sick all the time, a lot of stuff is just ruled out, right? Or if you're very short, I think I have way down here on the page, it says, at the bottom of the page, it says, I'll never drink or have a baby. That's a typo. I'll never dunk. That's what that's supposed to, like a basketball?
Yeah.
Okay, on an 8-foot hoop, right? But on a 10-foot, it ain't happening. It's not available to me. Your body limits who you are and what you can do. All right. Now, a lot of different things to say about this. Let me pick one on this list. A lot of times you'll hear people say, well, you know, you shouldn't care that much what somebody else looks like. I'm great with that. Dynamite. Good for you. Right? Or the body really is not what's crucial. It's the person's mind and their soul and their soul. That's great. But where is the mind or the soul or who they really are? The only access you have to those other elements of a person is their body. That's all you've got to go on. That's the way you communicate with other people. You've got, you know, you look at them. Well, if you can't see, okay, that changes the relationship. Right? If you can't hear, that changes it. Or if they can't talk. Right? Or if you look at them and they're so funny looking, you just can't stop laughing. There it is. I mean, that's basically all you have to work from. All you have to work from. The body is your unique, the way I put it here, the body is your unique means of expression. So if I'm standing here talking, I have a voice, right? Thank heavens. And every so often my voice gets croaky, and I'm like, what if this is permanent? Right, which is very possible. You get older, next thing you know, students come to class, they're not listening to sociology. They're like, Chambliss is, you know, he's the croaky guy. Right? That's it, right? Or I have a thing on the side of my head, a little blob, right? A little lesion of some sort. They're going to cut it off in a couple of weeks, okay? It's fine. Don't worry. It's not dangerous, but it's there. So I look at people, and they look at me, and they go, like, what's over there? You know? You can't help it. That's just the way we are. Eh? That's why I'm having it taken off. Because I don't want it to be a big part of me, like the croaky voice. Oh, yeah, Chambliss, croaky voice guy. Or worse yet, I lose my voice altogether, which happens to people. You know who Diane Rehm is? Diane Rehm's a public radio interviewer. Does this great show out of Philadelphia, I think. And it's been on for many, many years. She's fabulous. She's got a voice problem. She's got a serious voice problem. Every so often it gets so bad she literally can't talk. She's a radio personality. You know how that screws up her life? In a big way? And she's a lucky one. She's still on radio. Most of the people that happens to, you don't even know who they are because they didn't get there. You can't do certain things. You can't be a college professor if you can't talk. Sorry. That's just the way it is. Okay. It's the only way you have of expressing yourself in the world. Gestures, same thing, right? We'll talk in a few weeks about where gestures come from and why you use this gesture instead of that gesture and how much difference that makes and whether you're fluid about it or not and if people get distracted by the way you do it and so on. Your body's your only means of transportation. Yeah, they're cars, I understand that, but you gotta get in the car, right? You've gotta be able to function with it. If you can't walk, right? That's a serious problem. It totally changes the way other people think of you and the way you think about yourself. So there's a philosopher at Baylor University named Kay Toombs, T-O-O-M-B-S, phenomenological philosopher. This is what she does. And she's written all kind of great stuff about the effect of disease and disability on the self. She has multiple sclerosis. Okay, she's been in a wheelchair since she was 28 years old. And the change that made in her life was just unbelievable. She was a different human being in a lot of important respects than she was before. So worth reading if you're interested in this sort of thing. Another philosopher you may have heard of, Iris Marion Young. Anybody? Iris, yeah, right. She does great stuff. Well, she's dead now. She died just a couple years ago. Kind of feminist philosopher, phenomenologist, big on Merleau-Ponty. Wrote a kind of famous essay. It was called "Throwing Like a Girl." You know what we mean by throwing like a girl? Does that expression mean anything? What does it mean? How do you throw like a girl? Right. You kind of know what it means. Most of you who throw don't throw like a girl anymore. Okay, that's been a big change in the 30 years since she wrote that essay. But she wrote this really interesting essay about why was it that girls threw that way? What was going on? And she tried to capture what it was about being female in America in 1980 that made girls and young women use their bodies in certain ways that boys didn't. Jumping across a stream was another example she gave. And I'm not going to give you the answer because it takes too long, but it's, again, it's really worth reading. Right? How do people present themselves? Right? So if I stand up straight, I look different than if I don't. You know, it's just, there we are. And there's no way out of it, you understand? Because you're always standing in one way or another, so to speak, or sitting. Right? A person in a wheelchair, people in wheelchairs get treated differently. They get treated more like children most of the time. That's a problem, right? They're treated as if they're not there a lot of the time. So, you know, a person will talk to the person who's pushing the wheelchair, that kind of thing. Okay, I'll never dunk. Oh well. Although Spud Webb could, he was shorter than I was. Do you know? He was a pro basketball player. He's 5'7", 5'6", even they say. He could dunk a basketball. Go Spud. Okay. Let's see if we can say a couple other things about the body here and then move on. Most of the time I'm unaware of it because I'm used to it. I'm used to living in the body that I live in and doing stuff and tying my shoelaces and brushing my teeth and taking showers. I say I took a shower this morning. It's an immensely complicated operation that you're so used to doing it doesn't mean a thing until you sprain your knee or an ankle or even hurt your finger. You know, you cut your finger, and then there you are, and you put on shampoo, right? Something's not working. And it takes, I mean, the amazing part is it takes so little to screw up things. all right, that you cut your finger or just twist an ankle a little bit or a knee or any of that. And all of a sudden, all kinds of big routines have to be changed, which is to say that 99% of the time when things are working well, you're going through all kinds of complicated stuff with no awareness of it at all. Okay, that's important. Okay, but occasionally you see your body as a stranger. For instance, when I was your age and reading all this phenomenology stuff, one day I was lying in bed. It was in the middle of the afternoon. Okay, you remember the lazy part? Okay, so there I am, like lying, and I had my arm kind of propped up like this. Let me see if I can get the visuals here. Okay, there's my arm. That's my hand in a totally relaxed state. And I go, and you just try to pull the muscle just on the back of your hand, let everything else stay limp. And it's elegant. It's so elegant. Look at that, you know, the fingers curl together like that. Ain't that cool? Right? And I just sat there. I was not stoned. I was not. It was just, look at that. Isn't that incredible? And it is, right? And people like, I don't know, Michelangelo used to draw pictures of hands and things, you know, because they really are. It's an amazing, amazing little device. So there you are. You have this little sudden awareness about something about your body that you're not used to. Or, Goffman writes in a bunch of places about the social failures of the body. So the example I gave a week or so ago was, you know, the professor sneezes in class. Like, oh, bad, bad. Nobody listened to the rest of the class. Right? But we have tools, you know, so there's belching and there's breaking wind and there's, you know, little stumbles. When you're walking along or you start saying something, you get a frog and you go, oh, I mean, rare. Everybody's like, what was that? Like, I had some stuff in my throat. Oh, yeah. Right? So you cough or you have a handkerchief. Ladies used to carry fans, right? So when they blushed, like this, pretending to cover up the blush, but in fact drawing attention to it. Right? Or you have deodorants, or you have shampoos, or you have scissors to cut your hair. I mean, walk in the bathroom of any adult woman in America, right? It's this array of tools for managing the body and all sorts of, I mean, you all have all this stuff, I know that, right? We all do. I'm shaving every morning, I'm brushing my hair. There's a good, I do, I'm not making this up, right? Well, you never know, every little bit, right? You've got all these tools for managing your body and body failures and things of that sort. And Goffman says that one of the curiosities, I think you'll read this in the Deference and Demeanor article, actually, is that in, for instance, mental institutions, people, prisons and places like that, people are often deprived of those tools. And then they look bad, and then people go like, oh, God, that person looks awful. That's terrible. They must be a mess. But they've had all the equipment taken away from them, right? So that limits their ability to project themselves as a competent adult, as Goffman would say, all right? So, all right, Spanx. You know what Spanx are? Okay, it's another kind of tool for managing the body. Toothpick would be a different example. Okay. A lot of times you see the body as a stranger. That's the major message here. Worst case scenario is when you're sick. So pain of any sort, all of a sudden your body becomes this hostile, kind of aggressive thing. And it raises the issue of, well, there's a curiosity in our language. We tend to say we have bodies as if there's a me. And then I've got this particular possession that I'm really close to, but it's kind of like a car or house or something, right? I have a body. But when you're really sick, you can see it that way. You can see, like, I have a body, and it's been invaded by a bug or something that maybe we can cut out. But the other possibility is that I am a body. This is me. And I think that's much more likely what happens. I mean, the bad thing about being sick is you can't get away from it. Everything else, like if your friend is obnoxious, you can leave. Right? If they're super obnoxious, it may be hard, but you can do it. But if your body's obnoxious, you can't do a damn thing. I mean, you can go to the doctor and hope they can do something. But in the end, you're stuck with it, because that's who you are. And with some diseases, like you say, I had the flu, or I had, the intestinal crap last week or whatever. And that was bad, and you remember that was bad, but now you're over it. But other things like arthritis, I mean, once you have arthritis, you've got arthritis. Or diabetes, or leukemia, or something, right? I mean, some of these things, once you've got them, that's you. That's who you are, right? I'm arthritic or whatever. So, anyway, I don't know the point of that, actually. Oh, I do know the point of that. It says it right here. So, the self, it includes this thing about I have an idea of who I am, but that idea at some point has to be rooted in my physical presence in the world. Okay? I have a body, and I'm stuck in the world with that body. Now, the phrase stuck in the world is the one I just used the first week of class. It's kind of my own cheap version, not totally accurate version, of this concept, which is, yes, show that, right? Being in the world, which comes from Heidegger, and 1927, something like that, book called Being in Time. And it's hyphenated. It's a translation from German, but it's hyphenated in German. And it's the idea that human existence is defined by the fact that it's completely tied up with the world around it. That is, there's no such thing as being on your own if you're a human being. Now, by contrast, this little podium thing, in Heidegger's term, can exist, more or less on its own. That is, it's a physical object, and it has limits, and it's not going anywhere. It's not going to turn into something else. All right? And it has a place in the world, but it's closed in on itself. Right? It doesn't have what we would call a future. Right? It can't change. It is what it is. Whereas people have to. People, by definition, I mean, what it is to be a human being is that we have an open future and we can do stuff. We're alive. But we're always doing it. Sartre would say we're always in a situation. We're always in situation is the way he puts it. Right? That is, we're never in ourselves. We're always amidst everything else. Okay? So yeah, there's the physical body, but it's the very nature of human bodies, because they're alive, that they're engaging with the world around them. Okay? No escape. No escape from that. All right? And that means you're responsible. All right? And I'll hit a few other thoughts on this, and that'll call us a day. All right, so I say the body, what we've got here at the end, the body's being there, being in the world, being stuck in the world, makes it the basis of a self which is presence. Now, you don't have to worry about the terminology, okay? I'm just trying to get at this idea in a couple of different ways. Okay, so you're present in the world in a couple of ways. You're present like a roll call, like the teacher in fourth grade reads the names and you call out your name, and you're here. You're available, right? You're also here in the sense of responsible, in the sense that you can do stuff. And in fact, you have no choice but to do stuff. You're also present in the sense of you're available to other people. They can do stuff to you. Now, God bless us, everyone. So far, the world has been quite good to everybody in this room. Other people have been good to us. Now, you may not feel that way, but trust me, you're way better off than lots of people in the world. All right, we're the lucky folks in terms of the way we've been treated by other human beings. We are far and away the lucky folks. Jesus, that could change. You know, what if the country turns into Rwanda or Bosnia 20 years ago or whatever, right? I mean, Europe in 1942, the whole place was going to hell fast. Right? That happens. So you're present in the sense of you're living in the face of other people, many of whom have done horrible things and will continue to. So you just kind of go, okay, I'd rather stay at Hamilton. Right? That's good. But you're present that way. At the same time, you're present in the sense of being an affront to everyone else. You're in their face. Here you are. You're making a statement. You're at a party and somebody walks in the room. You've got no choice. You've got to respond. A, ignore them. Act like they aren't there. B, say hi, how are you? D, like, oh, shoot. Hi, how are you? Fake it, right? But you've got to do something. Now, a lot of times people try not to. For instance, you ever had somebody who refused to speak to you? Where they got really mad at you and just like cut you cold and will walk past you in a hallway or something? I had, okay, 25 years ago, let's pretend, this happened to me, right? And this person, I don't doubt she had reasons, you know, and they're good in some sense. And she refused to speak to me, you know? And this was somebody I was living in the same building with, you understand? It was impossible to physically avoid. She would act like I wasn't there. But of course, you can't. I was there. People knew. People like, what's with her? Right? You can't act like she's not there. There's only doing this, which is pretty consciously acting like I was there. Right? She was quite deliberately trying to make me invisible, but it had the opposite effect to everyone around. It made it much more obvious that we were on bad terms. At any rate, so you're present all the time. You're present in multiple senses, in time, it's here, it's now, right, in space, and socially. No way out of that. But, hint, hint, coming up shortly, we will see lots of ways in which people try to pretend that this is not the case. Okay? So if a fundamental aspect of having a self is being present in this sense, right? Or being responsible in Sartrean terms. It's also a pretty fundamental characteristic of human beings that they act like they aren't. All right? And that turns out to be this tremendous transition into the later part of the course. All right? Because it forms a link between a free self and people who act as if they aren't free. Okay? Great. Thank you very much. That's it.